Colossians chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brothers in Christ at Colossae. Grace to you and peace from God our Father. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of the truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed the whole world it is, in the whole world it is bearing fruit and increasing, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth, just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. These are the words of God. Well, at the risk of sounding like a broken record, can I encourage you please to open up your Bible, whether on your phone or a hard copy in front of you, so that you can follow along with the words of Scripture and see it for yourself. Before we jump in, can I invite you also to bow with me as we ask the Lord again for his blessing upon this time of the Word. Our Father, we have come to you, and our great desire is to worship you, and this is what we have sought to do. You know, O Lord, that we have many needs that we need you to provide for. You have made us a needy people to be dependent upon you. And Lord, with all the things that demand our attention in this life, all the things that we need to get to, you have said through your Son that man shall not live by bread alone, but every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And so speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. We come to enter into a place that was once forbidden. We enter behind the curtain because of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we come into your presence, not proud, but greatly humbled. And we sit at your feet now. Lord, speak and help us to listen. May you get great glory, and may we be transformed into the likeness of your Son, having met with you and heard from you. And we pray for the precious ministry of the Holy Spirit to bring this about now. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever listened to a song or loved a particular song, and then someone comes up to you and says, do you know what that song's actually about? You know what that song actually means? And when that happens, either one of two things occur. You're pleasantly surprised at how deep and wonderful the lyrics are, or you're absolutely mortified at what you were enjoying and delighting in. And you find out that the song was more than just the chorus, and it was more than just the melody. There was a purpose behind it, and there was a message behind it. Now, this would set us in good stead when we come to the Scriptures. When we read the New Testament, especially when we come to the letters, it is so important to remember that these letters were not first written to us. We don't open it up and say, God, I'm going through this, now what do you say? That's not how we approach it. They have a context. They were written by the apostles to local churches or to leaders who were going through something. There was an intention behind it. So as you look at different letters in the New Testament, say the letter to the Hebrews, these were Jewish Christians who'd come to believe in Christ, but they were being persuaded by false teachers to go back to Judaism. And so the author is writing and saying, Jesus is better than the priests. Jesus is better than angels. Jesus is better than the old covenant. Jesus is greater. Actually, it was all coming up to Jesus. Or you read the letter to the Thessalonians, to that church. And what do you see? error had crept in around the second coming. And some of them were being taught by false teachers that they'd missed it. They'd missed it. So what now? I mean, that was the final thing on God's calendar. And I don't know, somehow we didn't get caught up in it. Or you read the letter to the Galatian church, where the teachers were coming in, preachers had risen up saying, yes, Jesus, but to get into heaven, also the law, also circumcision, also all of these things, Jesus plus. And Paul argues justification by faith in Christ alone. They all got a context. And so does Colossians. The church, the letter to the church in Colossae. So before we jump in, and we're going to get there this morning into some of the following verses, we just need to see first in these opening verses, what's going on here? What's the context? Why? What is happening here? So we'll do a little bit of an introduction, work out what Paul's greeting is going on here. We'll lay the foundation because we're going to be spending many weeks building upon it. If you get the context wrong, well, you know what happens if you're a few degrees off. Verses 1 to 2, we find so much. So the letter you see opens with Paul identifying himself. Paul is the author of the letter. In the West, when we write an email or send a letter, we normally sign off with our name. In the ancient world, you signed on with your name. So Paul is the writer here. Where's he writing from? Those of you know, I've got a desk out the back in one of those rooms where I can send emails and prepare sermons. I've got a desk at home. Where was Paul writing from? Well, we get a crucial detail to the context in the very last line of the letter. The very last line, it says this, Paul writes, I, Paul, write this greeting with my own hand, remember my chains. Where's Paul's desk? He's imprisoned. And he's imprisoned very far from home, all the way in Rome, actually. And he was imprisoned because of the gospel, because he was preaching the gospel. And he was awaiting trial before Caesar. And you must remember, in the first century, Caesar was pretty much king of the earth. And that's who was waiting for Paul. So Paul writes while imprisoned. And he says he writes on his behalf and also on the behalf of, you see there in verse 1, and Timothy, our brother. Timothy, that young man who joined Paul in his second missionary journey back in Acts chapter 16. Very young man. Paul took him on board as a son once he got converted. And he trained Timothy. He mentored Timothy. He brought Timothy everywhere with him. So Timothy saw Paul preaching in the streets. And he saw Paul preaching in the synagogues. And he saw Paul preaching in house churches. And he watched, and he watched. And eventually, Paul took this young man, very young, and said, I want you to be the pastor of the church in Ephesus. And so he did. And Timothy would come frequently to visit Paul while he was in prison. There's the author. What about the date? When was this written? Well, Acts 27, we read, as you may remember, that perilous sea voyage that Paul went on the way to Rome, and then the ship crashes, breaks down, and Paul ends up on Malta. And eventually, he gets on another boat, makes it to Rome, where he is in prison. And so, he's writing this letter approximately 62 AD. Christ had ascended about 30 years earlier. It's been 30 years since Christ had gone. Now, who are the recipients of this letter? Well, verse 2, we find out that it is the church at Colossae. I've got a map, if we can just put it on the screen. Now, you'll see there, Colossae was located in Phrygia. I've got the blue circle. Sorry, it's a little bit small. It's about 160 kilometers east of Ephesus. You can see just there on the left of it. And you can also see around Colossae, you have the seven churches that Christ wrote to in Revelation. They were actual churches, okay, in Revelation. You know, Pergamum, Thyatira, Ephesus, and the list goes on there. And then you can see some of the churches that Paul planted in Greece. They're all the way on the left. You have Thessalonica, which we have a letter to. You have Corinth, and so forth. Thanks, guys, for the slide. Just a couple of things with Colossae. It was a once thriving city. Under King Xerxes in the 5th century BC, it was a thriving city. It was located in the middle of the trade routes, and the city of Colossae used to export wool and dyes, and they thrived in that business. But then, in the 1st century, around Paul's time, they redirected the trade route, and it went around Colossae and directly to Laodicea and Hierapolis. So Laodicea and Hierapolis, they started thriving, and what happened, Colossae started declining because they weren't on the trade route. And then around 60 AD, a massive earthquake came in to the region and decimated the city. Didn't fully recover after that. Now, the Colossae population was mainly Gentiles. So as we're looking at this, we're mainly going to be looking at Gentile Christians here. But there was a strong Jewish community that had settled in Colossae around this time. So there were Jews there. The primary religions in Colossae, remember they were part of the Roman Empire, 1st century there. So the Roman gods played a massive part. But there was also the mystery religions, the mystery cults like the Gnostics. They had a heavy influence. And there was some Judaism around because of the Jews that had settled there. Now, a little bit about the recipients, the Colossians. It's interesting that Paul, though he founded many churches outside of Israel, he didn't found this church. He didn't establish this church. Paul mentions their founder in verse 7. We see who it is. It is Epaphras. Now, Epaphras was originally a local of Colossae. He lived there. But when Paul was in Ephesus, which we saw wasn't too far away, Epaphras came over. Epaphras heard the gospel under Paul. He was saved. And what did Epaphras do? He did exactly what the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well did when she heard the gospel. He went back to his city and he preached to all of his townsfolk. And people got saved. And you know one of the people who got saved? That slave owner, Philemon. And then when Christians, when some started becoming Christians, they met in Philemon's house. That's where they did church. And so the church was born. We need to ask the question, why does the Apostle Paul write to this church that he didn't found and didn't have any part of? He didn't evangelize there. So why is he writing? Well, in the early church, in the 1st century, there was two strategies that Satan had in attacking the church to try and wipe it out, to destroy the church. What were those two strategies? One, persecution. Did that work? No. It only spread the gospel further. What was the second strategy? False teaching. False teaching. And this is what Colossae, the church there, faced. An infiltration of false teachers. And as we look through the letter, we're laying this foundation because Paul's going to raise things and he's going to hint at some of this false teaching that was prevalent. Now, some of the things that came up was Judaistic legalism, keeping Sabbaths, keeping the Old Testament ceremonial laws. That's going to come up. But then some of the more difficult things through the mystic religions. Paul's going to talk about these false teachers who go on about all the visions that they have. All these visions of God, and also the worship of angels, and all this high knowledge that only the elite attain. He's going to talk about asceticism. The way to true spirituality is really harsh treatment of your body. That makes you spiritual if you treat your body harshly. All of it is going to be focused on Christ is not enough. You need these other things. You graduate from Jesus when you believe in Him. You get your little ribbon. You get to wear the nice hat. But then to live the Christian life, you go beyond Christ. And that's why this book, Colossians, just keeps coming back to Christ. Christ is supreme. Christ is everything. He's going to influence your workplace. He's going to influence your family. And He's going to influence the community. And He's going to keep presenting Christ. Everything. He's just going to make inroads into Christ in every paragraph. And we're going to see that. So Paul writes to them, not as their pastor, but how does he write to them? Look at the opening line. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, an apostle called by God to speak for Christ, to proclaim Christ, and to represent Christ. And notice how Paul became an apostle. What does he say? Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. Paul understood, and he wants us to know, he didn't apply for this job. He didn't aspire to become an apostle. He was made an apostle by the will of God. God chose him. And it's reminiscent of Moses when he's before the burning bush and God says, I want you to go to Pharaoh in Egypt and get my people out. And Moses says, I'm not going. I can't do it. And it's reminiscent of Jeremiah. God says, I'm going to get you to speak to the people. And Jeremiah says, I'm too young. I'm too young. And God would have none of it. Because he chose them, and he called them, and he set them apart. And Paul says, I was chosen by the will of God. I didn't choose this. He chose me. And so look now how he addresses them. Again, we're still in the introductory greetings here. Look how he addresses them. Verse 2, to the saints. To the saints. Now, that word there means the holy ones. Now, with our modern ears, when we hear the word saints, we think immediately conjures up thoughts of Roman Catholicism. Saints. And in that religion, the term means those who've lived a life of heroic virtue. That's what a saint is. Someone who's lived such a noble life that they earn the title saint. That is incorrect. That is not how the Old Testament uses the term. That is not how the New Testament uses the term. We don't become saints by earning it after living a certain moral high life. We don't get that title. We are made saints, the holy people of God, the day we believe in Jesus Christ. Holy ones simply means those set apart for God, set apart unto God. That's what the term means here. And so it's drawing us back to the Old Testament with the priesthood. Now, God had 12 tribes in Israel. He chose one of the tribes, the Levites, to be set apart for the ministry in the temple, set apart as holy unto the Lord to serve him in the tabernacle. Now, the Levites, they were not more spiritual than the other tribes. They were not more super spiritual. They were not greater believers than the other tribes. But God took them and set them apart as holy unto him to serve him. So when you get to the New Testament, the Apostle Peter, in his first letter, chapter 2, he says, you have all been made a kingdom of priests unto God. All of you have been set apart as holy unto God. Saints are not some people that are so far above us and have earned the title. Paul says, you all are. You've all been set apart unto God. And so he calls them saints. And you'll see in verse 2, he also calls them faithful brothers, faithful brothers. Now, that word there literally means brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, the brethren. Now, Paul could have addressed them as the faithful Christians or the faithful disciples of Jesus. And that would be true because that is what they are. But he doesn't use that term. By the Holy Spirit, he chooses to use a family term. He chooses a family term. And he calls them brothers and sisters. Now, this is very significant. In the first century, a Jew would walk up to another Jew and greet them as my brother, brother. But here, for a Gentile to greet Jews, for a Jew to greet Gentiles, Paul, to the Colossians, and call them brothers and sisters, and he'd never even met them. This is a different kind of community. This is a new thing that was happening, a radical shift. So how could these Jews and Gentiles be called brothers and sisters? How is that? How could these Jews and Gentiles be considered family? How does that happen? Well, what does he say? To the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. There's the family bond. There's the family tie. They are in Christ. And this becomes a favorite term of Paul some 33 times in his letters, in Christ. Now he says here, you are the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ at Colossae. Now that is an incredibly significant phrase. Do you see their two residential locations there? their physical residence is in Colossae. And because they all lived in Colossae, they were neighbors. But God moved them from neighbors to family, brothers and sisters, because their spiritual location was in Christ. So they physically lived in Colossae. They spiritually lived in Christ. And so neighbors became brothers and sisters. It was just the last week someone asked me, how are you settling in? How are you finding things here? And I said, you know, one of my favorite things that I feel is I love the sense of community that everyone are locals. We're all locals and we all live in the same suburbs. We're all close to each other. However, if we simply just lived in the same suburbs, we would be neighbors. God has moved us from neighbors to family because we are in Christ. We are in Christ. And so these words here, what we're seeing here in God's word, this is not just slices of information for us. These are living, glorious realities of what we have become. And so if Paul were writing to us, he would say to the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ at Druin, family. Now he concludes the opening greetings with a blessing at the end of verse 2 there. Grace to you and peace from God our Father. Grace and peace. Two things that the world so desperately needs, right? A sinful, fallen, rebellious world. No matter what this world does, we could never undo our offenses to God. We need grace. And a world that is looking in every nook and cranny to try and obtain peace for all of their misery and turmoil. Grace and peace, the two things that the world so desperately needs, every Christian has received in abundance from God, haven't we? Grace and peace. And he says they come from God, our Father. God the Father, he sent Christ. He caused us to believe, and now we have salvation in him. So that's the context of the letter. That's the introductory greetings. That's the foundation of what's going in. Now, Paul breaks out into a toast to God. A twofold toast of thanksgiving and celebration. And that's where we're going to spend the remainder of our time. Let's consider these two toasts that he presents to God of thanksgiving and celebration. The first one is thanksgiving for the gospel's effect in Colossae. If you're taking notes, thanksgiving for the gospel's effect in Colossae. Let's read verse 3. Verse 3. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you. When we pray for you. Who is the grace and peace from? Back in verse 2, it's from God the Father. Who does Paul always thank when he prays? God the Father. Why this emphasis on God the Father at the beginning? Why is that? Because for the rest of the letter, he's going to be preaching about Christ. But he wants to remind us, Jesus is not another God. Jesus is not a new God. Jesus isn't separate from God. You cannot understand Jesus apart from the Father. You cannot understand what he's done apart from the Father. And so he brings us to the Father here. And he says, when we pray, we always thank God for you. Paul bursts out into thanksgiving here. We ourselves as a church, on October 16th, we're going to have a celebration Thanksgiving service in the afternoon. We've got much to be thankful for, but what filled the Apostle Paul with thanksgiving? Why is he celebrating here? Well, look at verses 4 and 5. What's the thanksgiving for? Verse 4. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of this you heard before in the word of truth, the gospel. Why is Paul so thankful? Why is he bursting with celebration here? Because a miracle happened in Colossae. A miracle took place in a seemingly insignificant city. Something of eternal significance happened. A people who once sat in darkness saw a great light. A people who once worshipped dead idols met with the living God. A people who were lost were found by the great seeker and savior of sinners. And they met Jesus Christ. This people that were in the bonds of Satan. They found God. In Colossae, the truth became a reality. The old was gone and the new had come. And a magnificent transformation had occurred in the city. A great victory. He says, we heard, or didn't see it, we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. Your faith, we heard of it. Now, our world uses that phrase so flippantly, don't they? Faith. Yeah. You just got to have more faith. Have faith that it'll all work out in the end. Come on, a little bit of faith. For a culture that has rejected the Bible, we use that term a whole lot, don't we? What's the problem with such faith that the world talks about? It misses the object of faith. What good is it believing in a bungee cord if it's not anchored to a post? What good is believing that skydiving is safe if you don't wear a parachute? What's the problem? They're missing the object of faith. It's just empty. And Paul says, your faith is nothing like that. Why? Your faith is in Christ Jesus. Faith in and of itself is insignificant. It's not impressive. It's the object of faith, what you're trusting in. That is what matters. What is faith in Christ Jesus? It is to see Jesus Christ as God's ark for us. It is to swing into a fearful eternity on one rope. Not on your morality, not on your church attendance, not on all of your good deeds. One rope to base and stake everything on Jesus Christ and Him alone. As the hymn says, my hope is built on nothing less but Jesus Christ and His righteousness, His blood and righteousness. That is faith, to trust Christ. Have you done that? Do you have faith in Christ? Do you rest on Him as you face eternity? Paul was thankful for their faith in Christ, and their faith wasn't the counterfeit kind. Look, it was the real deal. Look at verse 4. It was proven real. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus, and here it is, and the love that you have for all the saints. This was real. This was a true change. In the first century, in the Roman Empire, it was a loveless culture. A loveless culture. It was horrible. The rich oppressed the poor. The learned oppressed the uneducated. Slavery was rampant. And every form of wicked self-indulgence was celebrated and practiced. And in that wicked, loveless community, the gospel landed, and a Christian community was born, a loving community that broke down every barrier of hostility. The rich and poor became family. Jew and Gentile became family. Slave and free became family. And the world watched on in amazement, and they were drawn in at this new thing that was unheard of before. See, true love that comes from God is so different to the world's love. It's a divine love. That's why in verse 8, what does he say? Epaphras has made known to us your love in the Spirit. It's a love that comes from the Holy Spirit. It's the first fruit of the Spirit. He's mentioned the Father, he's mentioned the Son, and he's mentioned the Holy Spirit. The world doesn't understand love, but Paul said they'd experience the real deal. You know, our view of love has been so tainted and we've been so influenced by our culture. Love is a kind of feeling. You fall into love, you fall out of love, and so marriage breaks down because you don't feel what you once felt many years ago. Or love is kind of this force that you got to try and catch. It's like a train that comes by and you just hope you can get onto it. You know, love is in the air, right? Hopefully you experience it. that's not biblical love. It reminded me of that famous story of that young little 8-year-old boy. You remember an 8-year-old boy had a younger sister who was dying of leukemia. He was told that without a blood transfusion, his young sister would die. His parents explained to him that his blood was probably compatible with hers, and if so, he could be the blood donor. They asked him if they could test his blood, and the little boy said, sure. So they did it, and it was a good match. Then they asked if he would give his sister blood, that it could be her only chance of living. He said he'd have to think about it overnight. The next day, he went to his parents and said he was willing to donate the blood. So they took him to the hospital, where he was put on a bed beside his little sister. Both of them were hooked up to IVs, and a nurse withdrew some blood from the boy, which was then put in his little sister's IV. The boy lay on his bed in silence while the blood dripped into his sister, until the doctor came over to see how he was doing. The boy opened his eyes and asked, "How soon until I die?" He thought he was giving his life for his sister. 8-year-old boy, a brother's love for his sister. How did Paul open up and address this church? To the faithful brothers and sisters. You see, we have a love that is of a different kind. It's not like the world's love. It's a love that has received, been received from the Godhead. Jesus said to us, "This I command you, love one another as I have loved you." That is the kind of love that marks the Christian community. And Paul says, you guys are the real deal. You're the real deal. And he celebrates. And now this faith in Jesus and love for all the saints, it was energized by something. Where does this come from? How does this happen? Well, look at verse 5. It's because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of truth, the gospel. Hope. It comes from hope. Faith, hope, and love. Paul comes back to it again here. However, when he mentions hope this time, something different happens here. Normally when Paul mentions hope, he uses it as a verb. To keep hoping despite adversity. Just keep hoping. That's not how he uses it here. It's not a verb. It's a noun. Paul's talking about the object of our hope. The thing that we hope for. Not to keep hoping, but something that we have. What is the Christian's hope? What is it? Our hope is the spoils of everything that Christ won at the cross. That's what our hope is. What's the world most afraid of? Most afraid of? Death. What's our hope? We will rise from the grave. What does the world spend all its money on? Trying to keep itself young. Trying to stay young as long as possible. What's our hope? We will be given new and perfect bodies like our Savior. What is our hope? What we do not see, our faith will be turned to sight. We will see the Lord Jesus Christ, and you won't just see Him, you will have Him. He will be yours, and we will live in the presence of God forever. No more sickness, no more suffering, no more Satan. No more of your sin that you've had enough of. It's all gone. This is our glorious hope. Friends, where is our hope? This glorious hope, where is it? What does Paul say in the verse? This hope that is laid up for you in heaven. It's all stored up. It's all kept safe for you in heaven. Can I tell you, that is exactly where you want your hope to be kept. Exactly. Where does our world put its hope? Where is it? Where is it found? In wealth and in health. And that's why these fragile things of wealth and health, we are offered insurances of every kind. Why? Because these things that we put our hope in, they're so fragile. And we do everything that we can to keep them and not lose them. It's everything to this world. It's fragile. And yet we know with all the insurance in the world, we cannot keep our health. And we will not be able to keep our wealth forever. We can't. And Paul says our inheritance, our hope, It's in heaven where moth cannot get to, where rust cannot destroy, and where thieves cannot break in. That's where our hope is kept. And friends, our hope is not just kept protected from troubles that happen in this life. Our hope is kept protected from demonic assault. Do you remember when Satan came against Job? He was given permission to come against Job. And what did he do? He harmed Job's livestock, his wealth. He harmed Job's children, his family. And he harmed Job's health, his body. What do all three of those things have in common? They're on earth. They're temporal things. Christian, where is your name? Where is your name? It is written in the book of life. You have something stored up for you that nothing in this life or no power of hell can touch. Our inheritance, our hope is in heaven, and it's kept safe for us. It's exactly where we want it. Jesus says to them, your faith is in Christ, and your love for all the saints grows because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. This is why we always need to hear the gospel. It energizes our faith and it grows our love for each other. That's why we gather. Well, that was the first toast to God, thanksgiving for the gospel's effect in Colossae. I'm going to close with this second toast, and I'm just mention a brief comment because time has gotten away. The second toast is thanksgiving for the gospel's effect in the world. Look at verse 6. The gospel had come to them, verse 6, which has come to you as indeed the whole world. It is bearing fruit and increasing, as it also does among you since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth. The gospel had gone into all the world. Remember, Paul's writing about 62 AD, 30 years since Christ had ascended to heaven. In that 30-year period, the gospel has gone out to Syria. It's gone out to Asia Minor. It's gone out to Italy. It's gone out to Greece. It's even gone out to North Africa. We believe it, by that point it's gone out to Egypt. The gospel was going everywhere. Now, Paul says it's gone out to the whole world. That's probably a little bit of holy hyperbole or exaggeration. We're saying this thing is marching on. It is unstoppable, the gospel. But do you notice that's not what Paul celebrates about? Just that preaching of the gospel is going out in every city. That's not what satisfies the apostle. What is worth celebrating? What does he say? It is bearing fruit and increasing. It is bearing fruit and increasing. Does that phrase, bearing fruit and increasing, does that remind you of anything else you've heard in the scriptures? Have you heard that anywhere else? Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, what did God command Adam and Eve? Be fruitful and increase. Now we remember Adam and Eve, they sinned. They sinned against God. And when they did bear fruit, when they did increase, what did they produce? Products that were faulty like they'd become. They produced sinners. God became so angry with what Adam and Eve had produced over time. What did he do? Genesis 6, he destroyed the world by flood. Destroyed the whole world by flood, except for Noah and his family. When you get to Genesis chapter 9, what does God command Noah and his sons? Be fruitful and increase. What happens after that? What does Noah and his sons produce? More sinners, more sinners, more sinners. We increase and fill the earth. But we can only produce like, and we produce sinners. We've been fruitful and we increase. But friends, what we cannot do, the gospel has produced. What does Paul say? The gospel has gone out into the world being fruitful and multiplying. We produce sinners. The gospel produces a new community of believers, Christians. That is the power of the gospel. That is what the gospel does. It makes a new people. It saves. It brings life. And it brings hope and forgiveness in Jesus' name. And the gospel goes out to the whole world. And it produces incredible fruit. It makes persecutors like Paul become believers. It saves money-hungry people like Zacchaeus. It saves slave owners like Philemon. Self-righteous Pharisees like Nicodemus. And the chief of sinners, myself and you. This is what the gospel does, and it's gone out into all the world. So I close. This is what the gospel has done. You know, before the beginning of this year, I never even knew that there was a town in Victoria called Druin. Never did. Never heard of this place. And I'm really sorry. I was uneducated. But this place that I had never heard of had something in common with the rest of Australia. The gospel was here. And a people who'd come to believe in Christ, who'd come to love one another because of the hope that was laid up for them in heaven. And here you are, the family of God. For this is who Paul writes to. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for your word. We thank you for the great encouragement that it gives us. Lord, though we are thousands of years removed from the church at Colossae, we can identify as their brothers and sisters. The similarities are striking. You have caused us to believe in the same Savior, and we too, who were once in darkness, have also seen a great light. Lord, thank you for reminding us of the hope that we have in heaven. I pray that it may always be fresh in our minds so that our faith in Christ may only ever grow and that our love for one another may only grow. And Lord, may it make a great impact in this community of people who live around us, that they too may see a great light. Use us for your glory and in your service, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.